Hello, and welcome to worship today. My name is Edwin Weber. I'm one of the pastors here at St. Mark's, and it is a joy to have you join me on this, the 15th Sunday after Pentecost. And today is also a special day. Today is Rally Day, a common occurrence in our falls, though not quite the same as we might normally do. Today, Sunday, after our worship service, at the conclusion of our worship service, we are going to have a Rally Day parade here at the church. If you've participated in one of our drive-by celebrations before, you might be familiar, but we're going to ask for you to enter in along 25th, and you will probably see a line of folks. There are lots of exciting things going on at Rally Day, at the parade today. So join us. Some of the things that are going to be there, they're going to be special things for the kids, including coloring kits. There will be information packets for our WWL and confirmation folks. And we have a new directory to give out to you. So do please join us today for our Rally Day parade. Today is also the first Sunday that we're having a slightly different schedule. We are still gathering for worship at 9:30 a.m. as we have through the summer. We're not changing that. But with education opportunities coming back, we're doing a little bit of shuffling. Maybe you were able to join us this morning at 8:30 for our virtual coffee hour. We're now moving coffee hour before worship to accommodate that. Also, there'll be Alleluia Choir for our young ones at 8:45, worship again at 9:30, and then at 10:45, we'll have our education hour with both Godly Play for our young ones and a Sunday Forum for folks who want to participate in that. Of course, Adult Forum is going to be called to trust God's future as we explore more about the stories of the exile together. Our Theology on Tap group is meeting this Tuesday. If you're interested in participating, feel free to email me. I'm happy to send you the Zoom link. We are also kicking off this week our Thursday evening Bible study that is also led by myself. We're starting this Thursday at 6 p.m. You can look tomorrow. There'll be a video coming out with me explaining the Bible stories that we'll be studying for the week. And then we'll gather on Thursday evening via Zoom for discussion. And again, you may contact me if you would like to participate in that. I'm more than happy to send you the Zoom link. Our Stewards of Creation group continue to seek your responses to the survey that has been sent out. If you're joining us on Facebook today, you can probably just scroll down the page a little bit. The link to the survey is posted there. We are so interested in your thoughts and perspectives on these things and would love to hear from you. With that, let us begin our worship with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God, heavenly King, of Let us pray. O Lord God, merciful judge, you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in doing your will through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
The first reading is from Genesis, the 50th chapter. A reading from Genesis. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that he did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong that they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him, and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. The word of the Lord. The second reading is from the Apostle Paul's book to the Romans, letter to the Romans, chapter 14, a reading from Romans. "Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? Is it before their own Lord that they stand or fall? And they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then, each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in his anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Forgiveness is hard. When Peter asked Jesus, how many times do we have to do it? The Lord's answer is, a lot. Probably Peter thought seven times was being quite generous. Consider being sinned against over and over by someone seven times. Imagine the eighth time saying, okay, that's it, no more forgiveness, I'm going to get even. It could be much more satisfying to be off the forgiveness track and planning revenge. But no, Jesus says 77 times. In other words, you can't keep count. Then the Lord tells this rather ghastly parable about a master who forgives his slave an enormous, enormous debt. Then that slave won't forgive a fellow slave a much, much smaller debt. Debtor's prison for them, with no hope of ever getting out. Jesus says it rather more graphically. I read a theologian who wrote something like, jokes and parables should not have to be explained. If they do, forget it. There are some stories Jesus told that are kind of convoluted and need some sorting out. But this parable is not one of those. You can hardly miss the point. I'll assume you get it and turn to the Genesis story, which is a text I can hardly resist. You know the story of Joseph, I bet, the coat of many colors, spoiled and pampered. Joseph and his younger brother were the only children of their father's favorite wife, Rachel. The other 10 brothers and one sister were children of Jacob's unfavorite wife, Leah, or of some of the slaves. The 10 older brothers grabbed Joseph one day and sold him to slavers heading to Egypt. Fast forward many years, and Joseph is in charge of warehouses of food at the time of a terrible famine in all the land. Joseph's brothers come asking for food for their families, not knowing who they ask. There are some shenanigans, but eventually all of Joseph's family, with their slaves and herds, move to Egypt. In our reading for today, their father Jacob has died, and the brothers are afraid Joseph would finally take his revenge. So they scheme and lie and try to manipulate him. Joseph had already told them a few years ago that he forgave them, but obviously they didn't believe him. It was pretty incredible. It's hard to think of something that could have a more devastating effect on someone than selling them into slavery. A slave was completely at the mercy of anyone who owned him, and often there was no mercy. In fact, the brothers were quite surprised all those years later when they came to Egypt and found that Joseph was alive. The brothers had sold Joseph into mistreatment and death. How in the world could he forgive them? How in the world? That level of forgiveness does not arise naturally in this world. That kind of forgiveness requires divine intervention. Joseph had faith and trusted in the God of Israel. Sometimes the Lord works that deep forgiveness in our time too. What first comes to my mind is the aftermath of the shooting of people during the Bible study at Mother Emmanuel Lutheran Church. Mother Emmanuel Church, not necessarily Lutheran, in Charleston. They were kind and hospitable to the young man who came in. Dylan Roof killed 9 people. Dylan had been raised in a Lutheran church, our kind, ELCA. Dylan had become a white supremacist and wanted to destroy black people. After that massacre, many of the family members of the victims forgave Dylan Roof, publicly forgave him. Didn't you wonder at the time how they could do that? How could they forgive the slaughter of their loved one? Only with God's help, don't you think? Seems it would take a lot of prayer to get to the place where you could release your anger, even hatred, to forgive Dylan Roof. You hear those kinds of stories, and they stick with you because they are so amazing. I read about a young man who forgave the female officer on trial for shooting his brother when she went into the wrong apartment. Right there in the middle of the courtroom, he forgave her. Shootings, of course, get the most media attention, and so you remember them. But there are other stories of people terribly wronged in some way who forgive the perpetrator by the help of God. A lot of people can't even conceive of the hugeness of that kind of forgiveness. Joseph's brothers certainly couldn't imagine it. The brothers were functioning on a parity system. You benefit me, I benefit you. You help me, I help you. You hurt me, I hurt you. You would think that old eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth practice, as it was called, is an ancient way of doing justice. But it seems to have continued for thousands of years. Where do you see it in contemporary life? We have an obsession with the idea that nobody should get more than we do. Nobody gets a free ride. Even if they are crippled by life's tragedies, homelessness, unemployment, mental health issues, we say people should get what they work for. It should be all fair, the way we define fairness. And sometimes our anger is disproportionate to what we perceive as wrong. There is such a thing as righteous anger. on the part of our black and brown neighbors for centuries of abuse. But we push back. Where's the resistance coming from against working for true equality? I heard a woman the other day who said, "The black people want to get above us." That statement says two things. One is that the woman accepts that we have a society that has a hierarchy or a ranking of people. Some of us are more worthy than others, apparently. It also exposes the fear that working for true equality will give black people more power. Neither of these things are necessarily untrue, but should those concerns be what governs whether or not we want equity? I was telling our Bible study people on Tuesday about a faith group that criticized Franklin Graham for some of the things he has said and done lately. The group started getting hate mail then from Graham supporters. One woman wrote that she prayed the 13,000 members of the group would burn in hell forever. Really? A Christian would pray that? I thought about a couple of people I despise and asked myself, would I want them to burn in hell for all eternity? Nope. Think of someone you despise. Would you really want them to burn in hell for all eternity? The punishment the woman described is so outweighed the supposed crime of criticizing someone she admires that it's gone beyond an eye for an eye retribution. Forgiveness is not even a consideration in so many situations these days, even among people who call themselves Christians. What would some forgiveness do for our many difficult national conversations if that kind of generosity would prevail? Joseph went even a step further than forgiveness. He believed that the Lord had used his situation for good. Because of ending up in Egypt, he had been able to save his family and all their people and animals from starvation. It takes a strong faith to experience something as evil as he did and be able to see God working for good through what had happened. Someone in the Bible study group said the ultimate example of that is Jesus. He experienced the horrible torture of death by crucifixion, and he forgave the people who did that to him. From that terrible evil, God has fashioned a way of salvation for the whole world through Jesus' resurrection. You and I get the gift of forgiveness from Jesus, and that makes us conduits of forgiveness for other people. You know what forgiveness does? It opens up the future. Forgiveness breaks the bonds that have held you back. You are no longer tied to the past, to the bad thing that happened. Through forgiveness, the past no longer defines the future. You, beloved of the Lord, are open to whatever God is doing next. The theme at St. Mark's for the second year of our vocation project is called to trust God's future. For the children's talk today, you're going to hear a godly play story from Katie Cadlick about God's people struggling through being in exile. Called to trust God's future. That has become a touchstone for me. It's not just words, it is hope. I look at what is happening in our country and I am tempted to despair. Then I remind myself, I am called to trust God's future. I truly believe God intends good for us, and I pray to have the strength of Joseph's faith. Amen.
Please join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the Church, the world, and all those in need. You welcome us when we are weak in faith. Uphold your church throughout the world. Make it a place of welcome. Strengthen faith through Bible studies and Sunday schools, confirmation classes and youth ministries. Nurture all ministries of education and growth, especially WWL and Godly Play as we celebrate Rally Day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The heights of the heavens show us the vastness of your steadfast love. Have compassion on your creation, where human selfishness has brought ruin and destruction. We look to you to heal, renew, and redeem your world. We pray especially for those communities ravaged by fire and for the firefighters, first responders, and civil servants who labor tirelessly in the protection of life and property. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Make your ways known to the nations. Speak kindness to our bitter grudges. Settle our hearts when we want to settle accounts with violence. Bless our leaders with patience and wisdom, and guide those who seek elected office and all in positions of authority with your divine will for peace and reconciliation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bring healing and justice wherever harm is dealt. Provide vindication for all who are oppressed. Free victims of human trafficking and forced labor. Deliver all who are bound by debt. Free all who hunger and guard refugees fleeing famine, property, and war. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort us in every trial and hardship that we face. Be present with those who are sick, injured, or despondent, especially Josh, Bernadine, Louis, Phyllis, Gretchen, Jim, Steve, Verna, Eric, Ryan, Bowden, Nancy, Chris, Gloria, Arlene, Leslie, Terry, Kalia, David, Helen, Erica, Dave, Aaron, Janice, Nick, Bob, Joyce, Margaret, Knud, Lyra, Eleanor, Shelley, Carolyn, Cody, Sherry, Bonnie, Robert, Brian, Gail, Ron, Billy, Robin, and Bridget. Assure us again of your loving mercy, and let us never be parted from your grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Teach us to forgive. Remind us that you do not always accuse us. Still our tongues when we are tempted to pass judgment and argue over opinions. Make this congregation a community of mercy for one another and for all our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Whether we live or whether we die, we are yours. We thank you for those who have showed us faithfulness, for the knees that taught us how to bow to you, and the tongues that taught us to praise you. We pray for families of Dorothy Whetstone, Cliff Rankin, and Martha Ice at the time of their deaths. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now may the peace of Christ be with you always. At this time, I'd like to invite you to share signs of God's peace with one another. If you are gathered with other folks physically together in this time, greet each other in the name of Christ. If you are joining us over Facebook or YouTube, feel free to share the peace in the comments. And if you are joining us alone, know that the Spirit of God is with you and we are with you as well. This is the time when we would normally pass our offering plates, which is a little difficult when we are scattered in this way. We are so thankful for your incredible generosity during this time in supporting the ministry of St. Mark's and the wider ministries of our church. We could not do it without you. If you would like to give, you may mail in your donation. You may go to our website or look in the bulletin. We even have a text offering for you. So once again, thank you so much for your generosity in this time. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Sunday School Director, and I'm so happy to be bringing you the children's message today. Today is Rally Day, so that means that we are kicking off Sunday School. So join us next week at 10:45 for a video of Ann Benson, who will be bringing you new songs to learn, and then I will be doing a Godly Place Sunday School story every week. Today, I'm going to be doing the Exile and Return Godly Play story for you. It's a good lesson to remind us that no matter where we go, no matter what's going on in our lives, whether we're happy, sad, scared, God will always be with us, and he never leaves us. So let's begin. A lot of the stories in the Bible happen in the desert. And we can't have the whole desert here with us today, but we have a little bit of it. And the desert is a dangerous place. It's hot during the day, cold at night, and the wind blows and changes the sand. So it's easy to get lost. And the sand can also blow and hit your skin, and it stings and burns. There isn't any water or food in the desert. And people don't go into the desert unless they have to. It's a dangerous place. Here is Jerusalem. And in the walls is the temple that the people of God built for God. These are the people of God who would come to the temple and worship God. The people thought that the temple was the only place where they could go to be with God. They also thought that the walls around Jerusalem would protect them. But then came the time when the Assyrians attacked Jerusalem. It was a tough time. People fought, people went hungry, and some people even died. And finally, the Assyrians left. But then the Babylonians came, and they did not leave. their king wanted Jerusalem for himself. So the soldiers tore down the walls and they burnt down the temple. The soldiers marched the people of God out into the desert. And the people had to do what the soldiers told them to do. They had to walk when they told them to walk, march when they told them to march, rest when they were told to rest, and eat when they were told to eat. People looked back towards Jerusalem and saw it burning, and they didn't know if they would ever be able to go back. They were in exile. It took them a long time to get to Babylon. And when they got there, they hung their harps on the weeping willow trees and sang sad songs. And they thought about Jerusalem. And they would pray, and even when they prayed, they would face the direction of Jerusalem. And they would read scriptures, sing songs, and tell stories. And over time they realized that when they prayed and read the scriptures and sang songs, that God was with them. He was present. They could feel his spirit. Now the king of Babylon let the people take some jobs. Some people worked for him. Some of the people opened up their own shops. So they were shocked when the king of Persia came and took over Babylon. But he told the people of God that they could go home if they wanted to. So at first, a few people went back with Ezra. And together, they rebuilt the temple. A little bit later, more people decided that they wanted to go home. So they went with Nehemiah. And together, they built up the walls, Jerusalem. But not everyone went home. Some people stayed back in Babylon. They were not in exile anymore because they could go home if they wanted to. But the people realized that not only was God just in Jerusalem in the temple, but God was also in the strange foreign land, that God is with them everywhere. So I wonder what your favorite part was. Lector, what you think is the most important part of the story. I wonder which part of the story is for you. Where are you in the story? And I wonder if there's anything I could take out of the story, but still have everything we need. Thank you.
Today, we are all sitting in front of devices, participating in worship, and watching our leaders on our screens. There are many different devices that we use today, laptops and computers, smartphones, smart TVs. No matter how you join us for worship today, we are thankful for the blessing that technology provides for us. As our young folks return to school, we are mindful that many of us are experiencing new ways of doing old things. Just as we gather for worship in a new way, our students are going back to class, though not in classrooms right now. The technology that allows us to worship together is now the same technology that will be used by students of all ages to attend classes and learn this fall. While we would normally be having a blessing of the backpacks today, we thought it would be appropriate for us to have a blessing of the laptops instead. We are all finding ourselves behind a screen more these days, whether we are students studying online, family and friends visiting with one another, or telecommuting for work. Regardless, we offer up this blessing of all the devices used to connect us during this time and invite you and your young ones to participate in this blessing. You should feel free to take a moment, even pause the video if you like, to collect the devices around your home that will be used in this way. Or you could take time later to individually bless your devices. The three pastors hope to see you later this morning at our Rally Day Parade, when we will be handing out cards with this blessing and other prayers for this time. Now, if you have your device, I ask for you to place a hand on it, which is just an ancient sign of blessing used by God's people. Together, let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord God, the creator of everything good. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with the gift of technology, allowing us to be connected with one another during this time when we must be physically apart. Bless these computers of all types, laptops, smartphones, tablets, and smart TVs, which connect us and enable us in our vocations as students, workers, family, and friends. May our devices be free of glitches and annoying malfunctions so as to enable our study and work. May our internet connections be strong so that we may access the World Wide Web, connecting us to one another, making offerings of love, laughter, and learning. Bless our students as they commit themselves to another year of study, even as the means are different and pose new challenges. Bless teachers and administrators in our schools, that they may be sustained as they make necessary adjustments to the classrooms, enabling learning for all our students. Bless parents who facilitate at-home learning for their children, that they may be equipped to help their young ones. All of this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now receive God's blessing. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God, the Creator, Jesus, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. God is calling us today, leading us into tomorrow. Together, let us pray. Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go in peace. Remember the poor. Thank you so much for joining us for worship today. Have a wonderful day. And we hope to see you in just a few minutes as we gather for Rally Day, the parade. We can hope to see you anytime today between 10:45 and noon. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.